I'm complete with little Michael right here. I am ready to go.
Oh, isn't he so cute?
He's so precious.
He's an adorable little psycho killer.
Mm-hmm. I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day. Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and this is the podcast where we keep it classy as much as we can. Let me introduce you to my co-host tonight, my brotherhood of cinema here. First up is James Sullivan, also known as Hi My Dude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by a sneak peek photograph from the set of Michael Bay's Turtles 3, now in production.
Ah, James, why do you do that? You sick bastard.
This is the third one in this past week, and this is why I had to have my room bug bombed, because I woke up with bug bites all over my body. Video coming soon.
Details at 11. Mm-hmm. And we got a guest tonight. It's pretty cool. He does a lot of cool stuff on the line. He's got Happy Dragon Productions, DVD reviews. His buddy Andy does Foreign Flick, which we had him before, but it's David Rose. Welcome.
Thank you guys for having me.
And David Rose, David Rose, whatever this man does goes.
Nice. All right.
I'm sure I'll be a lot less cohesive now that I don't have any scripts in front of me. So, you know, I'm looking forward to this.
This is great. We just ad lib everything off the cuff. It's unedited, just raw cut. continue and conclude our spooktacular discussion on Halloween topics. Tonight we're going to talk about John Carpenter, the famed director of tons of movies. We're going to talk about three of them tonight. Actually, four. Sorry, four, because I forgot about Morgan. So let's start off with James as we go into something that I have not seen, but it's on Netflix. I might have to check it out sometime, but it's Big Trouble in Little China.
Shame on you for not seeing it yet.
I had so much time, and I mean, it's...
Yeah, okay, you get a pass. Okay, what I love about... Okay, so let's start off with a little bit about John Carpenter.
Go ahead.
We're at a point in his... It's 1985, 86. I think it was 85 when the movie was released.
86.
Okay, it was probably filmed in 85.
Yeah.
And he's got himself sort of a stigma at this point, where he's only directed horror movies, for the most part, minus a TV movie about.
Yeah, it's what he's known for.
Yeah, mm-hmm. minus Dark Star and a TV movie about Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, give those honorable mentions.
The first Kurt Russell collaboration, first of many great ones.
That came before this, but this would be what, the second one that he did with Kurt Russell.
Actually, the fourth after Escape from New York and The Thing. Mm-hmm.
Okay, mm-hmm. So wouldn't that make it the third?
You got Elvis, you got Escape from New York, The Thing, and then this one.
It's a fourth. Kurt Russell was Elvis?
Yeah, that was the TV movie that he did, that John Carpenter did. He actually did three movies like in the span of like a year, with Halloween, Someone's Watching Me,
mm-hmm.
and Elvis, mm-hmm. which was... That was like right after he died too, which is kind of crazy. So yeah, that was Kurt Russell playing Elvis, And that was their first collaboration. So.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, and that's also, I think, a role that he reprised in Forrest Gump. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
I just had to double check on that.
Okay. Okay, good.
I like the way the kid dances, you know. I think I'll steal his move.
Show me that little move you got there.
I like the way you shake those hips, boy. Okay, that sounded bad.
He had him a guitar case.
And so yeah, Big Trouble in Little China comes along, and it's great because Kurt Russell is allowed to not take himself too seriously with this role. Mm. He's a little bit more cartoonish. He's not the badass that you saw in The Thing and Escape from New York. He's just a trucker whose big pull is he's got an attitude when he radios everyone, and his whole motivation, he ends up in the middle of a gang war in the middle of China with thousand-year-old dudes waging war against each other, magic, fantasy, kung fu, and all this stuff. And all he wants is his truck back. That's his whole motivation for the movie. It's kind of like, you know, when you sit back and you think about The Big Lebowski and you realize all the dude ever wanted was his rug back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah.
He got caught up in all this shit.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
This is kind of the same deal. And he's not a guy with any particular skills except really good reflexes.
Yes. All in the reflexes.
Yes. but everybody else is around him, you know, they're he's stuck in the middle of this amazing little war going on that's dealing with a guy who's trying to break a curse. He has to find this bad guy has to find a woman with green eyes to break the curse. It happens to be the girlfriend of his best friend from Chinatown. So he's got to deal with that. And I love the typicalness of how this movie is set up in terms of its story. They managed to get so much corniness and witticism in there, and that's really foreign territory for a Carpenter film, especially mm-hmm. at this point when he's. I'm gonna say this. I'm probably gonna get some hate for this. I think The Fog was a little bit overrated. I like The Thing. I like Halloween, but I think as far as a horror director, Carpenter. He had a lot of great stuff, but he was also taking himself too seriously, and that's where this film gives him a little bit more leeway. It's centered around somebody who's cocky, very witty. It almost has a slight Indiana Jones vibe to it. I don't know what it is, but
Temple of Doom. I would say like Temple of Doom mostly.
Yeah. I guess it's the cockiness of Kurt Russell's character in the movie that does it for me. Jack Burton, me.
Jack Burton. Mm-hmm. Well, I would say that if Escape from New York, if Snake Plissken is Kurt Russell being Clint Eastwood, then Jack Burton is Kurt Russell being John Wayne. I mean, that is the accent that he does. It's basically him doing a John Wayne impression, and I think it's great. I think you also watch this movie and you're like, this is why they cast Kurt Russell to be Star-Lord's father in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, because that's exactly what Jack Burton kind of is that sort of, he's that blowhard character who doesn't always do everything the right way, and he just kind of cares about himself, and it's fantastic.
I'm Jack Burton, man. Interstate trucker. You haven't heard of me? But yeah, that film's interpretation of Star-Lord was based on was inspired by 80s culture as a whole, pretty much.
Oh, sure.
So
that Jones, that Han Solo, and I'd say even Jack Burton a tad bit.
Yeah, got a little bit of that sway cockiness there.
Mm-hmm.
I will. That's the thing is in Guardians 2, when they meet each other, they have to have a cocky off, you know.
Oh, I hope they do.
But and Kurt Russell he had done the cocky aspect before. He made it work with used cars, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So with this character, it's only natural. The only thing that would have been that would have really brought it over the top is if he ran into another truck or played by Sylvester Stallone.
Man, if only this movie did better when it was first released, that would have been the sequel, I think. That would have been great.
Jack, I've been working out while driving.
Well, I mean, we will have that Tango and Cash reunion because Sylvester Stallone is going to be in Guardians 2. I don't know how much, but he's got a little part in it. So.
Oh.
Tango and Cash, yeah.
Which I have not seen. Oh my gosh, I need to. Yeah, somebody shoot me. I need to catch up.
Well, we've all got our lists of shame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but yeah, I basically love Big Trouble in Little China. I think it's one of those films where they tossed around the concept for a remake for many years.
Mm.
Yeah, they did announce that last year with Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
Yeah. I don't know the status of that, but
yeah, I mean, it's still in development. It's not like it's going right away. I mean, The Rock's doing the Jumanji right now, so I don't know how long that'll take for him to do Big Trouble in Little China.
He's doing like 12 movies right now, isn't he? I think.
Oh, he's prolific. I mean, goddamn! I should do a podcast episode on him because he's like, damn, he's doing a lot now.
Well, they even talked about, I mean, they've been talking about remakes of They Live and Escape from New York. I mean, it doesn't end. I mean, they've already remade how many of John Carpenter's movies? I mean, Halloween and The Fog and Assault on Precinct 13. And Carpenter gets that paycheck, you know, so he really doesn't care that much, I guess, because everyone knows that any of these remakes won't be the same and they won't be as good as the original ones anyway.
I think they already remade They Live. It was called,
Oh, you're talking about Branded?
Branded.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that today. I was trying to look that up. I was like, yeah, sort of. It was like this film that came out and nobody ever watched it. But it was just like, yeah, it's got the same themes of it where it's like, it's a little bit of messages on the fucking walls. Like, don't even bother
watching everybody's. It. And everybody's got an alien attached to the back of their head.
A brain slug in his head? A brain slug.
I just remember watching the trailer for Branded and like, I just remember thinking to myself, it's like what if They Live was going to send you into an epileptic seizure? Because they flash these QR codes at the screen rapidly, and I'm just like, I can't watch this.
Consume, obey.
Everybody's in love with the burger.
Watch TV.
Yeah. And but yeah, well, we were still discussing Kurt Russell.
Yeah.
Let's see. I guess. I guess if they remade Big Trouble with Dwayne Johnson, he's got a very satirical sense to himself. He can pull off doing comedy, or at least trying to, but at the same time he's got his wrestling moves and whatnot that he's got to do. That would bring a different feel altogether to Big Trouble in Little China, because, like I said, Jack Burton is not a guy with any particular skills. So if we bring in The Rock, people are gonna start thinking, oh, is he gonna fight in this movie? Is he gonna do his wrestling stuff against, you know, Chinese kung fu? It might be interesting to see, or it could be a recreation of that one scene from The Rundown where he fought Ernie Reyes Jr. I don't know.
Kino. Oh yeah, I think they should, if they were to do a remake of Big Trouble in Little China, it should be Chris Pratt.
Oh,
and keep Jack Burton that kind of worthless character, because that's what makes it great. That's what makes him great. And if you're gonna put The Rock in a John Carpenter remake, do They Live?
Yes.
From one wrestler to another.
Yes, that makes sense. Okay. That makes so much sense, actually.
Maybe too on the nose, but I don't know.
I mean, not probably as Frank, maybe at most. I mean, not as Nada. But just Frank. I can see, like, Dwayne being, you know, Keith David like character, and then somebody else can be Nada.
Some other wrestler gun actor. You know, maybe they could cast Hulk Hogan.
Or they could just team up The Rock and Kevin Hart and see them fight in an alleyway.
Yep, that too, because they've been working so much now. Why not? I can just imagine in the alley just bitch slapping each other, just beating the shit out of each other.
He's just throwing Kevin Hart just throw him around the wall.
Kevin Hart is the new Frank, maybe. He's a replacement for Keith David.
Yeah. Yes, he's so small. He's
just equally as imposing.
Mm-hmm. You don't want to fuck with him. But, God. No, the thing with the only reason why I know about Big Trouble in Little China is because I like The Golden Child, and that it was at the same time, and it was weird. It was weird because they're both movies with the same theme, and John Carpenter had to get into production right away to beat the release date of The Golden Child. So he had to, he filmed in October of 85, just the release in July of 86 before The Golden Child's December release. So I was like, oh, wow, same year.
And they both flopped,
I think, from what I remember. Yeah, they both flopped heavenly, but it's like John Kirby's like, what's the coinciding of having these two films about Chinese, you know, adventure films, and it's just like, why? It's just like, it's a mere coincidence.
Yeah.
Chinese adventure films starring American actors as leads.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
John Carpenter just wanted to make a martial arts movie since he liked watching him, and
exactly
like how he kind of got into being a filmmaker so he could make westerns, and then the western died. But you still got Kurt Russell doing that cowboy thing, even though it's not a true western. Mm-mm. So kind of did it.
Although Chinatown is in my neck of the woods, and I'm out west, so
there you go.
There you be a go. Western.
Exactly. Not an old western, but yeah, a new western.
Exactly. Well, yeah. Chinese kung fu, they're pretty much westerns anyway.
Yeah.
With different weapons.
That's true.
But But yeah, I guess they really had to get their. I guess the Golden Child really had to get their animated Pepsi Man out there first.
Well, I mean, it was done by the time, John Carpenter was doing his film, so it was just like, oh shoot, we gotta release this before the Golden Child, so.
I just, if they did a remake of Big Trouble, it would not be as unique because you got all those crazy creature effects that are really cool, and there's a touch of horror in there that kind of like that same, like the thing kind of animatronic creature effects and things, and it wouldn't be the same. It would be just it was just watered down, and it also wouldn't be as unique because Big Trouble came out around. This was before, yeah, we'd had like Bruce Lee Kung Fu movies from Hong Kong, but we weren't really making any of those kind of movies yet. And it just wouldn't be as unique as it was back then. I mean, I would say you watch Big Trouble in Little China and it's like, yeah, the creators of Mortal Kombat must have loved this movie.
Oh yes.
Yeah, that was the big influence for Mortal Kombat. Exactly. Yeah, I was reading up on that.
Yeah, Lo Pan is Shang Tsung and the three storms are definitely Raiden, basically. So,
Exactly.
yeah, that's great.
But it just this movie just exploded into the atmosphere afterwards. Like it's a cult film and people freaking love it. 'Cause
Oh
there's
yeah.
like so many things now. If you look for things, there's comics and there's pop figures out now, and there's somebody's making a board game out of it. It's just like it's going crazy now.
Didn't they have a comic where it was Jack Burton meets Snake Plissken, I think?
Maybe.
I think I saw that like a year or a couple years ago maybe, and it's like that's cool.
Oh my
Yep,
gosh.
yep, 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 right here. Boom. Oh, it's coming out this month, actually. Boom will release a crossover
Really?
comic miniseries between Jack and Snake Plissken titled Big Trouble in Little China slash Escape from New York in October 2016.
They need to come
Escape
up with a
from
better
Little
title.
China? Yeah, Escape from Little China or
Something like that, yeah.
Big Trouble in New York. It's kind of.
Oh my gosh. I have to show this to you guys. Yes, you are right. There is Funko Pop.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Take a good look. It's cute little Jack Burton with big eyes and a gun.
You can buy those. I know
Yeah.
at the pop culture. I mean, let's see, comic book series. Yep.
I think I've seen a Lo Pan in yeah, there's Lo Pan right there. I've seen that one in stores. I don't think I've seen the Jack Burton one because I probably would have picked it up.
Well, now you can.
Yeah, and now I can just order it right offline. Nice.
There you go. Yeah, like I
Put it right
said.
by my By my Bruce Campbell and Michael Myers ones too.
There you go. But like I said,
Yep, a new bobblehead.
Yep.
They're doing like I said, they're doing a board game. Boom Studios is it's a cooperative miniatures game for 1 to 6 players. It's coming out next year. There's a card game.
Man.
It's huge now.
Yeah.
So it's
It's
it like I've never seen this before with a John Carpenter film. It's just like.
Even bigger trouble now.
Actually, do a sequel instead of a frickin' remake. That'd be better.
Sadly, most of John Carpenter's movies, especially the ones made at this time, bombed at first, and now everybody loves them because they see the influence. Like Grindhouse, that's full on John Carpenter.
Oh yeah, what are you kidding? They got Jack Burton back as a killer
Oh,
car driver.
yep, Stuntman Mike, I think his name was.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Always makes me want nachos when I watch that scene. He eats a good plate of nachos.
Okay.
Nachos.
Yeah, the Thing. The Thing bombed because it came out 2 weeks after E.T. And no one wanted to see a scary alien movie at that point. It's crazy.
And And the irony is, I would far rather watch The Thing over E.T.
I would say it held up better, yeah.
I mean,
I love E.T., but yeah, I agree.
I mean, no offense to E.T., but I was always like that kid who watched it and was just like, the first half of this is boring. And now I'm watching it and I'm like, okay, the first half is boring. Halfway through, it gets a little bit interesting. I see what the influence is, but I'm not one of those. This is a classic in my household. You know?
No wonder Big Trouble bombed at the box office. It was released around the same time as James Cameron's Aliens.
Ooh,
ouch!
You got sunk by the Cameron.
I mean, it was released 16 days after Big Trouble, but still, it just. Yeah, Aliens was just...
Sucked it up.
But
came along and drank the milkshake.
I drink your milkshake. I drink it all up.
I can see an alien doing that, actually.
Daniel Day-Lewis needs to play an alien at some point. He'd be great at it.
Who? Well,
you guys said
he pretty much.
Milkshake. That's Daniel Day-Lewis, right?
Yeah.
I wasn't really thinking that, but yeah, he could. He could announce another retirement and come back and say, "I'm playing an alien." That would be his big comeback, right?
Well, what he would do is he would announce his retirement. He'd go hang out with aliens for a few years, kind of get into the mindset, and then he'd come back and have an amazing performance. That's what he does.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
It's on my watch list, so I'll definitely watch Big Trouble, but if you haven't seen it, go watch it. Otherwise, please do.
It's a classic.
It's a classic.
It's unique. It's definitely unique.
Let's go back and talk about one of his most iconic films. Mm. Something that started off a whole genre of films, and it's still so many sequels and remakes, and oh my gosh, Halloween.
Okay.
Where do you start?
Where do you start with Halloween? How would you get in the mindset of that? I mean, such a classic.
I don't really know where you start. You start with John Carpenter, I guess, just being a hired hand, believe it or not. Like, these were the producers who wanted to make, like, a babysitter being stalked movie, and they were going to call it The Babysitter Murders, I think, as lame as that sounds. And they hire on John Carpenter, and, you know, John Carpenter had only done... First off, I really recommend, because I'm going to be doing this for a future review, I recommend Someone's Watching Me, which was a TV movie that John Carpenter, I think, literally finished 2 weeks before starting Halloween. And
I feel like somebody's watching me.
Well, you got to think of that. But, but yeah, it's just I think they came up with the whole idea of setting it on Halloween, and even they couldn't believe that a movie hadn't been called Halloween before. So, yeah, and you know, that where do you go from there? It's just like it's what, $300,000 budget, less than a month it took to shoot. Jamie Lee Curtis. The one of many Psycho connections.
Launched her career as a scream queen.
Yep.
Much to her chagrin, because she hated that, and then she finally capped it off by starring in Halloween 2, since she had starred in all these copycats like Prom Night and Terror Train.
Mm-hmm.
And she really became ashamed of it after a little while, until recently, I guess.
Well, yeah, there's. Because later on in the 80s, when she moved on with her career, and by the way, with a title like The Babysitter Murders, I want to say,
yeah,
we should have that only works if you have Elizabeth Shue stopping through halfway going, don't now, mess with the babysitter.
Yes.
It's funny that you mentioned that because Deborah Hill, she produced Halloween and Adventures in Babysitting. Rest in peace. John Carpenter's girlfriend at the time when they were filming Halloween.
Don't you fuck with the babysitter. That would be great.
Yeah.
I had to G-rate that because my dad was just walking in handing me some
okay.
popcorn.
Good timing.
Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, it's fine.
I didn't say it.
Yes.
But yeah, Curtis, through the 80s, she was rebranding herself as doing, you know, dramatic roles and romantic mm-hmm. comedies. And in the 90s, doing action movies like True Lies.
Mm-hmm. Back to James Cameron.
Mm-hmm.
Damn you, Cameron!
And then somehow I guess they talked her into H2O, which mm-hmm. afterwards she was kind of saying, no, I will not come back, not for any amount of money, not for anything. You can't do anything to get me back here. And then they talk her in by giving her $3 million and saying, you can come back with Halloween Resurrection, and we will kill you off in the first 15 minutes.
Now, was that, did they know that going into H2? Of course they go into all these knowing that Michael's not actually going to die for real, but was that part of the deal for H2O? I heard that she was maybe going to come back if John Carpenter was going to be involved, maybe, but obviously he didn't do it. I thought maybe it was like, well, you get to cut his head off at the end of the movie, spoiler alert.
I'm just going by the information that I know.
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure, but yeah,
mm-hmm.
that could be it. Because, yeah, that would have been, what a way that could have been to actually end the series if they hadn't done Resurrection and been like, no, she cut off the head of a paramedic who got his larynx crushed by Michael. That's why he couldn't talk. It's like, are you kidding me?
So, yeah, that's such a bad twist.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest of the movie was actually pretty decent too, but we're talking about the Halloween series here. They yeah. got the first with the first one. Let's jump back to the first one, shall we?
That's probably a good idea. I could talk about this stuff all day.
Yeah, with the first one, the thing that makes it frightening is, for me, partly that it's a slasher, but it's a slasher that's very believable. Like, like this could happen. They're not going too far over the top with it, not yet.
Mm-hmm. They didn't have to because there wasn't really any competition. I mean, this was, you could say this was kind of a descendant of Psycho, but it felt so different and it didn't have to compete with the Jasons or the Freddies yet. That's what mm-hmm. that's where the sequels come in. But I saw this movie when I was, I think, for the first time all the way through when I was 12, and this was kind of, and I may have probably at that point I may have seen maybe some of the Chucky movies before then, but this was kind of my gateway, and what a gateway it was. Because I mean, I think it's you see online people say nowadays, oh, Halloween, it's so overrated. Everybody just talks about how amazing it is. And I'm like, well, I think the age I saw it, and I still go back to that age every time I watch it, it's just kind of like, yeah, it is that amazing. I mean, I'd put it on my top 20 of all time just because, you know, it's the quintessential horror movie. I mean, it's and the fact that John Carpenter, his involvement made it so much more than it probably would have been without him. Like, it could have just, it would have been called The Babysitter Murders, and it would have felt like a movie called The Babysitter Murders. Like, it wouldn't have had this sort of classiness that it has. I mean, you have the director of photography, Dean Cundey, who brought in the Steadicam, and you have all those great, like, wide angle sliding, you know, gliding shots. And, you know, this is the guy who would go on to film, like, Back to the Future and Jurassic Park and Who Framed Roger Rabbit, and mm-hmm. he started with this, and it's just, it's stylish, and it's very, and it really plays with you. Like, you see, you watch it, and you see some of those shots where, you know, Michael's just standing there in the background, and then you go away for a second, you come back, and he's gone, and it's just like, it's so simple, and you have all these movies now that I think are trying to maybe emulate that a little bit, and it's just kind of like, well, we've seen it in this movie, and you can't really top it.
Yeah, my answer to people who look back on it now saying that it might be overrated or it hasn't aged well,
mm-hmm.
I use the same argument I used a year ago when Y-Boy and I were doing Monster Mash.
Right.
You have to look at it within its time period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The reason why your newer generation is looking back on this saying it's so tame now, is because we pushed the bar so much since then, and we've gone to ridiculous lengths, I'd even argue.
Oh yeah.
So they're probably used to that. Meanwhile, you can't just enjoy something that's a little bit more simple than what it is you're used to.
Simple, so, and slow, you know, kind of mm-hmm. slow moving. I mean, it's very deliberately paced, like a lot of like the good old horror movies were, like The Exorcist. You know, like that's not a scare a minute. You know, it builds up the atmosphere and the tension, and you got to do that. You got to do that for those more terrifying moments to work, and people just don't have the patience for that anymore. And
yeah, Dracula and Frankenstein were all terrifying back when they were released. You can't scare you can't even scare little kids with that anymore.
No, those. To me, I mean, personally, because of when I saw Halloween, I can look at that movie and still say that it's scary, but I do have to look at, like, you know, the Frankensteins and the Draculas and all that and be like, yeah, those are more of it. Even Psycho. I appreciate Psycho endlessly, but I've never really been genuinely scared by that movie. I just think it's well made, and it definitely, you know, pioneered so much. So
well, that movie I saw when I was a kid, that scared me.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of these, it does kind of depend on when you saw them,
mm-hmm.
too.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I saw Psycho probably for the first time a few years after watching Halloween for the first time, and again, I appreciated it, but yeah, it didn't, and I guess at that point, you know the twist, you know, you kind of go into these movies already knowing the twists just because of how famous they are, like Planet of the Apes or something,
mm-hmm.
and yeah, so it, to me, Halloween was just not only my gateway, kind of gateway horror movie, but of course my gateway John Carpenter movie. And we need to talk about that mask for a second.
I was just thinking about that, man. I was just thinking about that, David. It's in my head. I was going to say that.
We can't skip.
No, I was going to mention that because it's a cheap mask. I think it was like $1.98 or $2. It was a William Shatner Star Trek mask, and they just painted it bluish white and opened the eyes a little bit more. And that's it. It was like, it was kind of funny. It's like, William Shatner as Mike Myers.
I wonder if he gets residuals for that.
Well,
any royalties?
I think he sued. I think he did sue at one point, and that's why the sequels really veered away from having, because when you see that it's William Shatner, you almost can't unsee it, at least in the first movie. But then you go away from that, his likeness, a lot in the sequels, and I think that's because he did file a lawsuit at one point, I believe.
It could be, but then later on he didn't know that his likeness was in the movie, and then later on he said he was honored that happened.
Did he?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I was reading about that.
Okay.
So, I don't know.
You go on, if you just Google that, you'll see, if you like Google like William Shatner mask or something, you'll see the original mask, like a vintage photograph of the original mask, where someone's wearing it to display like a what you would look like as Captain Kirk for a Halloween costume, and even that's creepy because the eyes are still black. It's weird. And they also did, well, there's that
I'm
one.
I'm looking at it.
There's that
I'm
one.
I'm looking at it. Oh my gosh.
But there is a shot that I even saw recently where somebody's standing there wearing a you know, a Captain Kirk, you know, the shirt that he wore. Hold and on. He's wearing the Splendid. They even made one for Leonard Nimoy. And I'm like, in an alternate universe, they picked the Leonard Nimoy mask.
Yes!
Michael Myers with pointy ears.
Running would be illogical. You are running up the stairs. You should run out the front door.
This makes sense. Yeah, it's creepy, even the mask. Because the only reason why they cut the eye holes open more was just so the actor could see
exactly
better. It wasn't really for anything more than that. They combed the hair back. They just... Yeah, that's pretty much what it looked like, yeah.
The comparison.
Actually...
Just took some Krylon to it, and that's where they got the white from.
I know, and I was like, wow.
And they were going to do a clown mask at first. It was going to be an Emmett Kelly sad clown mask, and they were like, it's creepy, but then they did the William Shatner mask, and they were like, no, this is creepy even without the lighting and the, you know, all that stuff. So they went that route.
It's ironic, actually. I think as the movies went on, the mask that... there was at one point where I just looked at the mask and I said, it's starting to look a little bit... It's starting to look not like William Shatner, but more like Brent Spiner. So we're going to another...
Star Trek
we're going
actor.
To another generation of Star
I'll
Trek now.
Next generation, yeah. With those soulless eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Am I the only one thinking that? It also looks like Data.
Now that you mention it, yeah, I can see that.
the paleness. Pale
yeah. Mm-hmm. And actually, I think when they did Halloween 2, they actually had the same mask. I think Deborah Hill, I think she said she put the original mask under her bed, and a couple years later, she pulled it back out, and it was kind of distorted, but it was still the same mask that they used. So it does look like it got sat on a few times or something.
Yeah. Maybe that's what they should do, is they should... They should recut Halloween, inserting Data quotes.
It's
all through the movie.
It says
I am fully functional.
On IMDb, it says it looks different in the sequel because the paint had faded due to a few reasons. First, because Nick Castle, the original Michael, kept it in his back pocket during shoots. Also, Deborah Hill kept the mask under her bed for several years until the filming of Halloween 2, causing it to collect dust and yellow because Hill was a very heavy smoker. The mask was wider because Dick Warlock is shorter and stockier than Nick Castle, so the mask fit his head differently.
Mm-hmm.
So it was looks a different like actor watch, playing him.
Yeah, you watch Halloween 2 and it just looks like stretched over his face more than the original actor, who Nick Castle would go on to be a director, and he directed The Last Starfighter and Major Payne. The classic Major Payne with Damon Wayans.
Director.
Halloween started a bunch of careers for these guys, obviously. I mean, you got Nick Castle, you got Jamie Lee Curtis, John Carpenter, who had already done a couple things. Tommy Lee Wallace was like a production assistant. He's the one that actually found the masks. And he picked the clown mask at first, and then he went on to direct Halloween 3, Fright Night 2, and Stephen King's It, actually. So speaking of clowns.
Halloween 3, the film that gave us Tom Atkins.
Yeah, you bet.
I think I'm one of those people that sort of thinks Season of the Witch was actually a pretty good film.
I love Halloween 3, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even the official website just sort of acknowledges it, saying This sort of takes a departure from the other Halloween films. And it's always been that mild curiosity, this one Halloween movie that wasn't with Michael Myers.
Yeah. I didn't watch it for a long time because of that reputation, and then I did, and I'm like, this is good. It's a Halloween movie. I mean, it's unlike the first. I mean, the first one could technically not take place on Halloween and still work, but obviously Halloween 3 requires Halloween masks and the season and all that. It's one of the few actually Halloween movies. So mm-hmm. I think it's great. I think it's very underrated. Although I think thanks to the internet, I don't know if it's so much underrated anymore. I think people finally kind of communally found that movie and were like, this is pretty good. It's unfortunate that people hated it so much to where they were like, all right, let's bring Michael Myers back. And every sequel after that will be very repetitive. As opposed to being, you know, Halloween 3 was supposed to be the beginning of, you know, every year was going to be a different Halloween story.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And people want to, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, anthology kind of movies.
Yeah, anthology films.
Movies. Yeah, so. Yeah. But people wanted Mike Myers, damn it, didn't like, why? Why did not feature Mike Myers in Halloween 3? We need our Mike Myers and just... And then it takes 6 years later to have the fourth one to come out with the return of Michael Myers. So,
yeah. See if in an alternative universe where this film was actually successful, mm-hmm. we would not have Halloween 6.
Yeah.
Which is a guilty pleasure in my opinion, but
yeah,
we would not have the Thorn trilogy.
Thorn trilogy. We wouldn't have Paul Rudd though.
Oh.
Oh yeah. Yeah, where would he start out as?
Yeah, him playing Tommy, the little boy from the first one that Jamie Lee Curtis was babysitting.
Hmm. Yeah, so. He grew up and looked completely different.
Yeah, amazingly.
Don't worry, he'll be an Ant-Man later.
If Halloween 6 wasn't going to do it, Clueless was, so.
Of course. Yep, that's for
same year.
So, yeah, and even Halloween 3 was actually partly John Carpenter's idea, so everybody's always like, why did they do that? Well, it's John Carpenter.
It's because he produced it, yeah.
Yeah, so. Yeah. And he was like, after Halloween 2, the story's over. And back to the original movie real quick was like, what's also scary about it, and this is what people kind of forget, is that Michael Myers didn't really have any motivations in the first one, because it wasn't until the second one that they wrote in all the stuff about he and Laurie Strode being brother and sister. Mm-hmm. He was just going after people because he was evil. And the whole, you know, soap opera-ish family connection thing didn't happen until they were like, well, let's do an Empire Strikes Back or something where let's make them family members. And it's like,
make some sense of this.
Yeah. Let's try to bring logic to horror, which doesn't always work out, but I don't know. I like the sequels for what they are, but I just do kind of wish, I wonder what a successful Halloween 3 would have brought us a little bit more creativity.
Yeah. I think, some people with the first film, if that was just a contained deal, if they said, what the hell, this guy's still alive at the end, you know, everything.
That was huge. My dad talks about that when he saw it in the theater originally. That was shocking to people. It was just the mere idea that he just got up. And that's what's crazy about it. You got to look at this movie from a certain time period, yeah, where it's like that. Audiences were stunned by that.
Not even broken bones or anything. That would have,
right?
Even if you're wearing like a Kevlar vest and falling off the second floor of a house, you're gonna get some injuries. But it's kind of that's the only part where you have to accept a little bit of mysticism in there, because it's like, what the hell just happened there? And sometimes you bring up a very interesting point. You don't know his motivation. Sometimes you look at some people and they're just evil because they are.
Well, it's like what Dr. Loomis says about him. He's just pure evil. You know, that's why the Rob Zombie remake is terrible, because it turned Michael Myers into a redneck nightmare. You know, like that's...
Halloween 2 did that.
The homeless Michael Myers. The best part of that movie was Weird Al Yankovic saying, "Mike Myers like Austin Powers?"
Weird Al was the saving grace of that whole series, because I'm just like, he's actively coming in here and saying, you know what, screw this franchise. I hated that Dr. Loomis so much for being a self-important asshole.
Me too.
That I was just like, thank you, Al. Please stay in the movie. Please save this.
Can you be our new Dr. Loomis? That'd be fantastic.
I mean, Rotten Zombie, he went to John Carpenter when he was making it at the time, and John Carpenter just said, make it your own.
And we've even gotten an update of that story where John Carpenter kind of recently, and I don't know about the spin of all this, but even recently John Carpenter kind of said that he never really did give Rob Zombie his blessing.
Yeah, right.
And Rob, but again, John Carpenter is all about a paycheck. I mean, really, since he hasn't really made that many movies in the past 15 years, he's all like, well, if you want to remake my movie, you want to give me a paycheck, it's fine. I'm a capitalist, you know, I don't care. He's not really as sacred about his own stuff as his fans are.
And that's why we have the Fog remake, the Thing remake, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
Personally, I didn't mind the first Rob Zombie Halloween. I thought, okay, so they got to do something a little bit different. And on those grounds alone, I sort of thought, okay, that's acceptable. The problem with Halloween 2 is I don't like anybody.
Really like anybody in the first one either. I mean
at least the girl was somewhat likable. She wasn't Jamie Lee Curtis, but they turned her into a goth chick. And the second one, who hates everybody. I'm Michael Myers' sister. Look at me.
Yeah, well, and it was also that Rob Zombie thing of everybody just yelling the whole movie, like that's all it is, and he thinks that Kat.
Nice kitty.
There we go.
You just went over half of all the ladies in this podcast. You have a cat.
I wonder when she would make her little cameo appearance. But yeah, I could again talk about the remakes all day. I just thought that the first one was pointless, in the first place. Just the idea of doing one. But
yeah, Mountain Man Myers, I'll call it that.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, Michael the Brawny Man.
Yeah, remember how it was frightening when you didn't see his face? Well, now get a good look.
Take a good look at Sabretooth. Or the fact that, like, when he would stab somebody, now he's grunting. It's like he's supposed to be silent. You know, that's what always made him so creepy. Rob Zombie took everything that was creepy and scary about Michael Myers and just kind of, again, you're trying to bring logic and reason to them, and that's when the horror, I think any horror movie that tries to bring too much logic and motivation to the monster, like, is just completely misguided. Like, to me, one of the scariest shots in the first Halloween is when Laurie looks down at the laundry in the wind and sees him. You cut back to her, cut back to him, and he's gone. Now, there's no logic in that shot. He just disappears, but it's so scary, I think.
So the good news is that they are going to make a new one. Miramax and Blumhouse Productions are developing a new Halloween film. John Carpenter is set to produce and act as a creative consultant on it. He said, 38 years later, after the original Halloween, I'm going to help to try to make the 10th sequel the scariest of them all.
So wait, it's another sequel?
You guess so.
I think what they should do is Jurassic World it. It's kind of like, you know, we've screwed with the timeline, we have remakes, we have all that crap, but let's just say, okay, the events of the original Halloween happened years ago. People don't really remember it, but Michael Myers is going to return to show you that, yeah, that stuff happened.
We're gonna no we're, no no we're gonna Halloween H2O it again, or we're gonna Godzilla 1985 it.
There we go.
That's the movie I would watch. Michael Myers versus Godzilla.
Godzilla's going down.
I mean, at least Godzilla can die.
That's true. That is true. So, yeah, I just I think that it's cool that John Carpenter's actually involved, because he needs to do stuff. I mean, the only stuff he's on tour right now, because he is like with a backup band doing like theme songs and stuff from his movies, which is kind of cool. But other than that, he hasn't he did Ghosts of Mars and The Ward. Those were like his newest ones, and those are years old now.
I think his last direct, the Ward was like 5 years ago now, 2011. Yeah, so he hasn't done much. I mean, he is a great composer. I mean, that's another thing you talk with John Carpenter. He does his own scores, and it's amazing. Like I do listen to his stuff occasionally because it's just great stuff. I mean, it's oh man, you can listen to the soundtracks for days. I mean,
It's pure 80s. I mean,
yes,
that's, I
oh.
mean, talk about influence. I
Yes,
mean, he is, that is,
just
yeah.
drips 80s. Oh.
Yes.
Very minimalist synth score, but yet at the same time so effective. I mean, it's why these keyboards back here, they have a setting just called soundtrack.
Carpenter.
You might as well call it Carpenter because
Yeah,
that's what
right.
it sounds like. You know, you hit a chord on it, it's like I'm like, okay.
Daryl, 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 Daryl.
Yo,
Yeah.
yo, yo.
Yeah. It's just, and he does it, and that's what's so great about it. He just he works with low budgets because he can do so much himself, and that's why he's so. That's why all these, you know, aspiring filmmakers look up to him so much, because he just, you see, and even like when we were talking about Big Trouble in Little China, it doesn't, but at the same time, it does feel like a John Carpenter movie. It's like if John Carpenter made kind of a comedy, although I guess you could say that about Memoirs of an Invisible Man with Chevy Chase.
Still need to see that.
That one's fine. It's not the best Carpenter, but I kind of like aspects of all his movies, even the lesser ones. But he's an auteur through and through. Like, he, you know, it, every it feels he's got a there's a feeling to all of his movies, even though they're all very different, and
I
he does a
think
lot on them.
when it's interesting when not to go off topic here, when Don Bluth said he said this about animation, directing animation, he said you have to learn music. That's one thing you should always do on the side, which early on he did. He did some songs for his original stuff, but John Carpenter is very much the same in that aspect. Only somehow he gets to take over all the scores for all of his movies, so
Yeah. Except for The Thing. That was actually Ennio Morricone, who did a lot of the original like spaghetti westerns. And but you could definitely but it still felt like you could have easily just said that that was him doing it almost. It feels like a John Carpenter score, but John Carpenter, I think, was very much influenced by all that kind of western stuff with the minimalistic sort of music, and just Yeah, I mean, I think his dad was a musician and he just kind of learned through osmosis and the amazing, awesome, one of my favorite themes of all time, the Halloween theme, is just like a weird kind of 3/4 time thing that he learned on the bongos, and then that becomes the repetitiveness on the synth, and it's one of the scariest pieces of music ever, I think.
It's so scary that they remix it for the dance hall, you know?
Yeah.
They got disco club mixes
Yeah.
and all this stuff.
And nothing beats that, just that original piece that he put down for the opening credits of that first movie. They've remixed it, they've redone it every time. They've even added more orchestral stuff to it, like an H2O, and it just doesn't have that same feeling to it. The impact's lost. So.
Partially. I say a close second place in terms of additions were when they decided to add in more drums to it. But that gave it sort of a that almost gave it sort of a more rock vibe.
It's true, yeah. Which, speaking of rock, he's a musician to the point where even he and then Nick Castle, who played Michael Myers, and then Tommy Lee Wallace, who was the production assistant, they have a band called the Coupe de Villes. And they did, if you go, you can find there's a song for Big Trouble in Little China, I guess it plays during the end credits, and they did that. So you've got John Carpenter actually singing the title song to Big Trouble in Little China. And there was a music video and everything. It's on the DVD.
Oh,
Yeah, it's,
wow.
again, awesome 80s cheese.
There you
So,
go.
yeah.
Well, I think we've said pretty much everything that can be said about Halloween now.
Pretty much, I think.
I've come here to chew bubble gum and kick ass, and I'm all out of bubble gum.
Ah.
I wonder what movie you're talking about.
Gee, I wonder why. Maybe it's not the
Starman.
Starman. It's
Duh.
maybe it's not the movie that has the clip from the intro that I use. God.
Maybe it's the movie that has Jeff Bridges singing New York, New York.
No, it's a movie called They Live from 88. It's an interesting movie, and if you watch it now, it actually makes more sense. Like it's still going on today because it's more like a satirical kind of thing on media today and even in the
Oh, yeah.
past in the 80s. So I mean, he Carpenter made it because of the whole Reaganisms of the 80s, you know, kind of the whole consume this, consume that kind of thing, society. And because it's funny enough, because I'm taking a college course about media, and the teacher actually showed a clip from They Live in class. Just like, yep, this is what media was. Yep, look at that. Obey, watch TV, consume. That's what media
Sleep.
is.
Yeah.
Not was, is.
Is.
And I have a, I actually have a funny thing about that because, Reagan didn't start commercialism.
Well, right. Yeah.
We've had the over-advertisement of pretty much everything,
Right.
what, since the 1950s,
Right,
60s?
yeah. But it was just, yeah.
But I do have to agree, there are times where it really gets overbearing, and that's part of the appeal of They Live.
Well, it's 80s excess, you know, that you always hear that term thrown around, but I think that They Live kind of plays into that, but it does it in a way like say American Psycho is a movie about the 80s, but They Live is about the 80s in the 80s, and it kind of captures that same vibe that you would probably get from a movie made these days made about the 80s. Even though it's funny because you see the stuff about the media in They Live, and you're just thinking, wow, it was so quaint back then. They thought it was bad then.
This is actually based on a short story
Oh,
called
really?
it was a 1963 short story called 8 o'clock in the Morning by Ray Nielsen. So Carpenter took the rights from the short story, and actually this story was adapted into a comic book adaptation. So he just took those and kind of wrote a script out of those two things and got They Live out of it. They Live is basically, in a nutshell, about a drifter who comes into town, discovers a pair of sunglasses, and realizes that society as we know it has been taken over by aliens undercover. Nobody knows about it because these sunglasses, you can see the aliens' face, and you see all the advertisements or whatever in the world in black and white, being like, watch TV, sleep, and whatever, you know, consume, you know, all these things relating to media, you know. And he has to, with a couple of friends, has to, you know, stop it from becoming even worse. And what's great about it is because they casted Roddy Piper. Rest in peace, dude, because Roddy Piper is like he's like the best thing about the movie. Like, they casted him because John Carpenter has seen him at a wrestling event in 87, and he wanted to cast somebody who wasn't like a trained actor, like, because he originally wanted to give the role to Kurt Russell, but, you know, he just wanted somebody that's rugged and, you know, like an average Joe kind of character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, somebody who had that physique, you know, that you could imagine him just a life of hard, grueling physical labor, and appropriately enough, I mean, he gets, well, like a construction worker job at the beginning, and he looks like a construction worker, and yeah, he just kind of has that everyman feel and isn't, like you said, a seasoned actor. And yeah, I think it was WrestleMania in 87, think it was.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. I think, if I can get my facts straight, people in the comments been like, it was this one.
But actually. Yeah.
WrestleMania 3, 87. Yep. But yeah, it was weird because you don't even hear the character's name either. You see in the credits his name is Nadia, which is kind of like a hint to the short story, I guess. But
A short story. The character was Nada, and I think it's kind of meant to symbolize like nothing. Like I have nothing.
Yeah.
And the character is nothing.
Yeah, which is kind of cool because you don't hear his name often, but it's just like it's pretty cool. I was watching it today, just a refresher, just a little thing, and you see the movie has a build up. The scene, you know, Piper coming in, and you see him drift into town. You see him trying to get a job, trying to, you know, establish himself. He meets Frank, played by Keith David. Oh my God, Keith David! Oh my gosh,
I know,
freaking great actor. He was cast in this movie because Carpenter liked his performance in The Thing. Oddly enough, so it was like, yeah, which puts you in here too, because you're that great. And then I was looking at the time too. 30 minutes in, you see this all happening. He gets the sunglasses. He looks around, and sees all the plaster stuff, and sees the aliens. And you see his buildup. You know, he's walking around, and he starts like, he's like, you are ugly. You are just so ugly. Like, it's got just, you need to see a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
Formaldehyde face.
Yes.
Suddenly he's like so rude to everybody on the street.
Yeah. Yeah, so he just like, and then
doesn't give a rip.
He doesn't. And then later on, he runs into the cops, and there's some cops that are kind of with aliens, some are like real people. And he shoots them, and then he gets the shotgun from them, and he starts going to a bank, and he's like, says his famous line, which was ad-libbed.
Yep.
Ad-libbed. It was from a list of lines that he would say at, like, WrestleMania or something, anything from wrestling. So he just, like, he said it. It wasn't in the script, so it was pretty cool. He starts shooting up everybody with a shotgun, which is awesome. He's like, ba-bam, 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 bam. Such a badass. And then...
You reminded me of something. That the line, that line there, it's kind of funny how famous that's become, because I've actually read, when you see it popping up in freaking news articles, I was reading this one article years ago, something about the U.S. Army, something about a war, and the headline was, U.S. Army, quote, all out of bubble gum. And I was like,
what?
Solid. No way they didn't.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's funny.
And I think it's one of those sayings where people just, they say it and they don't even know where it's from. It's that ingrained.
Exactly.
If Big Trouble in Little China was influencing a Mortal Kombat, I think this influenced Duke Nukem, because Duke Nukem said all of those things, and he would say things like Bruce Campbell would say in the Evil Dead movies. And I mean, he literally did say, "I came here to chew bubble gum and kick ass." I mean, they ripped the line right off of this
Yeah,
movie.
they
And he wore
paraphrased it.
sunglasses and all
Yeah.
that, fought aliens.
Oh yeah, that was that was when that game franchise was getting way too cheesy.
Yeah,
I
that was
think.
yeah, that was the Duke Nukem 3D when they did that.
I
Oh
was like,
yeah.
okay, give me the set, give me those old side scrollers again with the little
Yes.
guy and
That was my Duke Nukem, was the side scroller before he even started talking. Yes, I love the old DOS games.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, we
That's
need to stop
what I
this
was
now
playing.
before he starts slapping around alien tits on a wall.
Graphics, who
Yeah,
needs
that's it's like it's that line is just unbelievable. It's just an awesome line and it's very quotable. Everybody uses it nowadays. But then later down the line, yeah, he has to show Frank the sunglasses. And
Ugh.
what comes is this epic fight between the two, trying to, as Piper tries to get Frank to just put the sunglasses on, and I think it lasts about 5 minutes and 20 seconds, I think.
That's all.
It feels like it's longer,
It lasts for
but
days.
it lasts for days. But it feels,
Yeah.
because originally it wasn't supposed to be that long, because it was like a choreographed kind of little fight scene, but then Piper and Keith David just like punched around and they kind of liked it and just kept it in, you know.
Yeah, I read something about that. I think mostly they said they improvised that fight, but at the same time, the rules that they abided by were okay. Any blows to the body were pretty much impacts and legit, but all the punches to the face were faked,
Oh, here.
or something like
One
that.
of the highlights of the film is a 5.5 minute alley fight between David and Piper over a pair of special sunglasses. Carpenter recalls that the fight took 3 weeks to rehearse. It was an incredibly brutal and funny fight along the lines of the slugfest between John Wayne and Victor in The Quiet Man. But yeah, so it was rehearsed, but then it just.
More Western references.
Yeah. He loves his westerns. You see those, you see them. Yeah, it's like the best part. It's just like you see them beat the shit out of each other. There's a part where Piper grabs a piece of wood, it starts whacking it, hits the back of a car, and I think it was it's Frank's car, I believe, because they had that look. And then like Frank, like I don't know what it was. I was trying to see what he had in his hand. He broke it off. He's like, God damn it! And then you see Piper smile a little bit as he was
Yeah,
like.
he's like, ha-ha. And then his face just changes.
Yeah, it was just like they had the most fun doing that scene. It's like the best scenes in the movie too. And then later down the line, they end up, you know, Frank sees what's going on, and he ends up finding the crew of people that are trying to resist it. And I dare not to reveal what happens, but because it's the movie, you have to see for yourself.
Yeah, that ending is great.
It is. It is. Once they accomplish what they needed to do, the ending part is just like.
It's dark and hilarious. I mean,
Yeah.
so it's bleak, but you're laughing.
Yep. Yeah, it's a film that one thing I always look back on They Live is I'm always hypercritical. And I remember talking about this with you, Dave, when you did your DVD shelf.
Time ago. One of my first ones.
Episode three.
On the episode on the film is I'm always wonky about these movies that are hypercritical on consumerism or capitalism when they're being produced by a hyper capitalist system.
John Carpenter is definitely a capitalist. He's even said it himself. That's why he loves the paychecks.
And but what I think saves this movie is that okay, You can take that for what it's worth. He obviously doesn't hate the system. He played into it. Made his career on it, and that's one reason why I think some people get the wrong idea with this movie. And the other thing is, if you're not in it for the message, it's campy.
Yep, exactly. Yeah. It's still fun.
It's campy.
I think, go ahead.
It's not campy in the sense that the effects are bad or anything like that.
No, it's not classic Doctor Who,
but
not that campy. Yeah.
The aliens are creepy.
John Carpenter wanted to give it the decomposing flesh kind of thing because the society's, you know, degrading down because they're trying to brand it instead of just the high tech aliens, as he called it. So,
well, I think it is funny whenever you do see any of these kind of movies that try to be critical about that kind of political stuff, because usually it's being made by filmmakers who are exactly like that. I think it's just maybe them trying to tell a story that speaks to the average person that would probably watch this, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't know. And kind of satirizing that as much the consumerism, as much as like a class division thing where you've got the poor people who are going to these, trying to find jobs, but then all of the aliens are a bunch of rich people.
Police officers. And,
yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true.
I know, it's a select number of people that are aliens. It's weird. I don't know. It's just, I was looking, I was like, there's policemen, there's rich people, there's business people, and it's just, it's a various amount of people that are aliens.
Yeah, I mostly go back to that, the old woman he runs into the grocery store with all the jewelry and the fur coat and all that.
Yeah, you won't believe how many people I had to eat to get all this jewelry.
No, the scene where he's still looking around with the sunglasses, he goes to the newspaper stand, gets a magazine, and he starts looking at the guy that walks up, and he's just like, just...
Yeah.
It's like, his reaction alone was priceless. So the reaction was so perfect. It's like, huh? What am I seeing?
I just the concept, when you tell somebody it's about a pair of sunglasses that allows you to kind of see not only people as, you know, aliens, or you see it's very, very unique. I mean, I actually it wasn't too long before I did that review that I had actually seen the movie for the first time, because it's just one of those that kind of flew under the radar for me for a long time. And then when I saw it, I was like, there really isn't a whole lot like this. Mm-hmm. And not enough people know about it.
No.
I did see, before I ever saw this movie, I saw the South Park episode that famously had, you know, Jimmy and Timmy, the handicapped kids, getting into a fight.
Mm-hmm.
That was literally shot for shot a remake of this fight. And it makes me laugh even more now, having seen this movie a bunch of times. That they took this fight as an inspiration for that, and, you know, slamming each other against the dumpster and all that stuff. I mean, you watch this.
Come on, Jimmy, put on the crutches. On the crutches.
I mean, you watch the fight in the movie, and it looks like it's real concrete. It looks brutal as hell. It's definitely a wrestling match. I mean, it not only did Roddy Piper bring the one-liners, but it really would have been a completely different movie if it was somebody else in that role, since he brought so much of his expertise, his wrestling charisma, and his know-how into this. So, yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Maybe they could remake it with Vin Diesel, now that I think about it.
Oh, that could work. That could work, actually. I could see, because Vin Diesel does have that average Joe kind of look, but he's bald, and he's kind of muscly. I mean, that could work, actually.
Put on the glasses.
He he seems to always like doing shades in the movie, so why not in him in his movies?
That's true, yeah.
Oh my god, in the real Ghostbusters, there's a line of it. I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ectoplasm, and I'm all out of bubblegum.
There you go.
How do you kick ectoplasm? Your foot would go right through it.
Oh my god.
Pull back all the sticky stuff.
Oh boy.
That somehow made it even more 80s.
I'm just trying to see what other references it makes from other films, and I saw that one, I was like, what the fuck?
So wait a minute. Somebody's actually considering making the short story version into a film?
I saw that. I was looking at IMDb. Yeah, 8 o'clock in the morning is being considered for development, I guess. So I guess they're trying to make it true to the short story then, I guess? Not the John Carpenter. But I guess they're also trying to do a remake of They Live as well, I guess, too? So...
Well, that's what they claimed the Total Recall remake was going to be, was closer to the original Philip K. Dick short story. And it's like, no, we're kind of just doing a bland version of the Arnold movie. Pretty much. Yeah. That's probably what this would be.
Probably. I mean, there's going to be two versions of this. Could be this one and then the remake, I guess, they're working on, which would be interesting. I don't know.
One rule about Philip K. Dick stories, they're never full-on adaptations.
That's true.
Yeah, it is true, actually. I've seen quite a few of those.
Come on, Blade Runner.
Yeah, Blade Runner.
Yeah, definitely not the same title.
Definitely not.
That would have been ballsy.
Would you watch a movie set that called itself "Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep"?
Only because I knew the source material. But yeah, your typical moviegoer, no. That's too long for a hashtag.
Well. Actually, you just reminded me. I watched a Netflix original film last night called "I Am the Pretty Girl Who Lives in That House."
Oh, I heard about that. Yeah, how was that?
For something that's a supernatural thriller that doesn't relies on horror elements but not jump scares. I stayed awake through most of it, but I turned it on because it was a nice, even keel movie to fall asleep to. But I wanted
that's
to.
That's always a good quote from a critic. This is good to fall asleep to.
I found better movies to fall asleep to because this one I wanted to stay awake and keep watching. I mean, it was so tame. It's not using jump scares or anything to tell the story. It's just giving you atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I prefer that out of my horror movies. You know, those jump scares, especially these days, are just so cheap and overused.
Mm-hmm.
Without any.
I'll post my full review on Facebook when I finish watching it.
Of course. But I just found an interview with John Carpenter talking about They Live, and he was asked about the movie, and he says. The question was They Live was a reaction to the Reagan years, but the income quality, corporate ownership of the media, all that is more extreme now than ever. He says, yes, it is. You have to understand something. It's a documentary, not science fiction.
Yes. It was a documentary. You know, we didn't have Roddy Piper scripted or anything. We just set up a bunch of cameras and followed him around, and we said, you know what? This is an actual mission. You have to pretend like you're an everyday man and go down the street, and this is a set of parameters, and these guys are just going to document everything. And he believed it, too.
The rest of his life, Roddy Piper believed in aliens. Yep.
He did, because I was reading facts about it, and he said he got a pair of glasses, and he was, like, pissed off that it didn't see the aliens, except for the ones on set.
What?
I don't know if he was that stupid, but I was just like, is that true or not?
Now, maybe he was just predicting Google Glass, you know?
Ahead of his time.
Or cardboard, you know, the VR. Be like, okay, slip on the smartphone. Oh, I see the aliens.
There's an app for that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, alien your face.
There's an app for that.
They live your face. That's a new app, you know.
But yeah, it's They Live is a film you have to see, like, especially in this generation. Like, you can see it nowadays, you know, especially from the 80s point of view. Like, it's still going on now with the capitalism and the, you know, the consumerism kind of stuff. So it's definitely something to watch. And Roddy Piper, rest in peace. Like, he, I miss him so much.
Heard he was such a nice guy too.
Yeah.
Seemed like it. Like, he really just, he, like, you listen to the audio commentary on They Live, and it's between him and John Carpenter, and Roddy Piper's just, I love doing this so much. Like, it's just, he was really, like, genuine about it. So, and also I would add, too, that They Live, I kind of put there, you know, put next to RoboCop as sort of these movies that, you know, you go into them and you're not expecting to laugh as much as you do because of how much they're making fun of the 80s. And all the, you know, all the commercials and all that kind of stuff. And again, you look at something like RoboCop and you go, man, that was so quaint back then, the media, the advertising, the in-your-face, always kind of stuff. And so, yeah, I definitely put it on that level.
I would agree. I would agree on the over-capitalism aspect. Only every once in a while when a phase comes through society, some sort of media craze that you find yourself just not being able to get into, but everybody else is into it. You know, like, everyone's talking about Pokemon Go. It's a great thing. Da 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 da. Pokemon Go is gonna stop now. And I was like, well, that's okay. I put on the glasses a long time ago.
This is funny. I was still reading the interview. It was on Yahoo, by the way, and he's talking about the Big Trouble Little China and how there's a remake, and he said that he hasn't talked to Dwayne Johnson, but he'd talk to him if he wanted to talk. And the interviewer says, the movie really found its audience later on. I was very young when it came out. Carpenter asked, how old were you? It was in 1986. He says, well, I just been born. What? Holy fucking shit. Why am I talking to you? You're a child.
Wait a minute. I was born in 86.
I beat you guys to it. I was born in 84.
Yeah.
But yeah. They Live. Definitely, definitely worth checking out. Definitely Indeed. Worth checking out. Oh boy, so here's a treat for all you listeners out there and watchers. We've got a disembodied Morgan voice to listen to now as he talks about The Thing. Because he had to talk about this and he didn't want to skip it, so. Let's see if I...
Hello, everybody.
Oh god. I was listening to this a little bit, so. Dear God in heaven. And, I think if you want to talk in between, just maybe raise your hand for me to stop in, and I'll play it after we're done talking, so. Or you can, like, do, like, a commentary and just talk over it.
Not to interrupt, but I'm interrupting.
Sorry, Morgan, I gotta talk about this. Okay. Shit.
Hello, everybody. The
This is the ghoulish voice of Vincent Price, reminding you that there are only a mounted, limited days to the most wonderful day of the year. So stock up on candy before those little goblins knock at your door with bags of flaming doggy doo. No, this is Morgan Letcher doing the worst Vincent Price impersonation ever.
I'll say.
Jonathan Harris. Ooh, the pain, the pain. This happens after you binge on 3 seasons of... No, strike that. 2.5 seasons of Lost in Space. Great show,
that's
by the
Peter
way.
Lorre, you
we sucked. Okay, we're here to talk about John Carpenter, not classic sci-fi, which is a shame because I would love to talk about Lost in Space, but oh well. With the, with this episode being on John Carpenter and the fact that I have a seasonal job every October, I don't want to miss out on this one. So, unfortunately, my benevolent out-of-body voice has to talk about this movie because I wanted dibs on this one so bad, but if no one else talks about this in today's episode, I should be alright. So, John Carpenter is such an incredible director. I like how he's able to tackle certain cultural issues, whether it be consumerism or one that we'll talk about in just a second, which is diseases. And yet, there's a running theme in most of his movies, isolation and lonesome. You have Kurt Russell playing the hero in every single one of them, and yet he's sort of the loner. He's the standalone. I don't want to say he's the misfit.
The
he's more of the one that's kind of like the outsider in a sense, well, with the exception of Roddy Piper in They Live, but you guys probably already talked about that one, so I'm not going to yak on about that much. But the one movie that always stood out to me from John Carpenter's batch would probably have to be his remake of the... Oh, no, hold on a second. No, it's not They Live. I've just talked about They Live. His standout film, to me, really, is his remake of The Thing, which, unfortunately, I have not seen the original, so I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
I do recall seeing,
like, I think, like, maybe the first 5 or 8 minutes, and, you know, I want to finish it, but someday I will.
Watch the sky.
But no, really? John Carpenter's The Thing is actually one of my all-time favorite horror movies because it effectively scares you in all the right places. Not just with the gore, but also with the environment, the atmosphere, the placing, the concept. Everything about this feels like a detective movie, but at the same time, it has the great aspects of a classic monster movie. If you take away the amazing ooey-gooey practical effects, but, you know...
And one thing I wanted to mention about in terms of the atmosphere of the film, does anybody else watch this movie and feel like they're cold?
Yes. Yes. Even in August. Mm-hmm.
I mean, you could watch this movie in the middle of summertime.
Yeah.
And it's amazing because they shot it in... Because I remember watching the DVD special features and they shot it on, like, back lots with patches of grass everywhere. Oh, you know all about this, of course.
Of course you've got it.
Oh, I've got them all right here. Got to give them fresh watches, yeah.
Yeah, so they weren't even on location in the Arctic, but everything that they did, both practically and not even digitally, just using matte paintings and whatnot, it was so effective.
Yeah.
Continue.
I'm here. The movie is about a group of explorers in the Antarctic. I can't remember what they're there for. I guess they're for study or some damn thing.
They're there to play
and,
cards.
And apparently an alien creature gets into their habitat. I'm not going to say how to avoid spoilers because this movie is really worth checking out. And sure enough, the problem is that this creature can not only assimilate but also imitate human beings. For example, in its first form, it becomes an innocent little husky dog. And you think that this sort of creature wouldn't go the full lengths to assimilate and do all these horrible things, but yet in its first scene, you actually see it enwrap all these different dogs all together and try to turn into one big blob of a monster. It's a horrible scene, but for some weird reason, I can tolerate it. I'm not a fan of animal deaths. I should probably stress that right now. I'm a dog lover. You know, I'm a furry for crying out loud. And I really do not like seeing animal deaths because they're the most easiest gimmick of all. And when you look into their puppy eyes,
learn something new every day.
The whole thing happens. It's horrible. It's just really horrible. But I don't know why I can tolerate the deaths of this. I don't know why I can tolerate the dog deaths in this one. I think it's because you don't see that much carnage done to them. And I think, you know, it's practical effects. Maybe that's why. Maybe it's because it's just all practical effects consuming them. But moving on, it not only can do animals, but it can also imitate, like, human organs and things. And that makes it a bigger challenge for the scientists and the explorers there. Because now they have to face the unfortunate horror that it could be any one of them. It could be someone that you just befriended, or just somebody you just had a little bit of a chat with. And that's what really gets under my skin a lot when I see this movie. I mean, yeah, I've seen it, like, a bunch of times. But the concept itself is so ingenious. I should probably forgot to mention this. This one and the original thing from the 1950s was actually based on a story called Who Goes There. It was a little short novella. And it's interesting how we have two different versions of that story. We have the 50s cliched monster movie. I really should see that movie, to be honest. I don't want to come off as biased. But we have the monster movie with the monster running around.
It's cliched 50s monster
movie. Not much of a body toll there. And in that version, if I remember correctly, they didn't do the whole it can assimilate or anything. It can grow a body part back if you, you know, chop off like a leg or something. It did that. But I think the 1982 version that John Carpenter did respects more the darker aspect
of this. Oh, I was
going to
say one thing. I would actually compare the alien in the original movie as more of like a Michael Myers. You know, it does kind of have more of that stalker kind of feel to it. Whereas, you know, obviously John Carpenter, then he did that. And actually, we forgot to mention how in Halloween, they're watching the original thing on TV. The kids. And obviously they're only doing that because the thing, the original one, was one of John Carpenter's favorite movies growing up. And you can see that passion. You know, that's why it is one of the greatest remakes ever, because it's not just because a studio wanted to do it. He wanted to do it and had the studio backing. So, yeah, I mean, that's all I was going to say about that.
Mm-hmm. That John Carpenter did respects more the darker aspect of this, of the story. The fact that you have no idea who or what this creature will morph into. And as you go along, not only do you piece together exactly how dangerous this monster is, but even the scientists as well. So there's that growing fear that the person that you're sitting next to just might be this alien creature that is literally going to consume you and become you just for the sake of safety. It's a horrible thought when you do think about it. Now, in terms of viruses, there seems to be a very underlying message that critics looked at the time that was supposed to be this variation of the AIDS virus, which is interesting to really do think about it. Because it was definitely a big issue at the time, this growing disease. Actually, I like to put my hat in the ring and say, I don't think it's just the AIDS virus, but this movie is timeless because of how we have a different, like, flu or a different kind of virus that comes out every single year that's affecting us. And just because we have that one thing, whether it be the flu, we stay away from that person just because he has that illness and that sickness. Because we don't want to be, like, consumed by them and get this weird kind of illness. And I think that's such an interesting thought when you do think about it. Because when we have one person that has, like, this weird, I don't want to offend anyone, but this weird cancer or something, I know it's probably not contagious, but just the idea of catching it and ending up like them is just a horrific thought. And that's really the feeling of this movie. You really feel bad for the characters that get, you know, consumed by the alien, and the alien becomes them. So now they're this bizarre creature that is not like who they were before. And that really raises the stakes, because you don't know if this creature can be stopped, you don't know if it can be reasoned with, you don't know if you can communicate with it, you pretty much can't. Which makes it all more scarier. You don't know if its intentions are world domination, you know if it's a good thing. Actually, it would have been kind of dark if, actually, in a comedic dark sense, it would have been interesting if they had the creature be like, I just wanted to bring a cure for the world. It's like this fucking ass thing with tentacles and a, oh, whatever the hell that giant head was. No, the characters, I don't want to say they're interesting. They're really, really interesting. Obviously, the standout is Kurt Russell. It's going to be Kurt Russell. He really knows how to do the tough guy attitude pretty well, which I find very weird because he started off at Disney. And then he went from Mouseketeer to Savior of the Universe and Escape from New York. No, I take that back. The asshole Savior of the Earth.
And this is why he was anyway, Walt Disney's last
for
word.
The thing, I think his character
Ooh, I got something.
Is very interesting because...
Before he was even in any of those Disney movies, he actually, when he wasn't the star or anything, but he was in an Elvis movie. He was in It Happened at the World's Fair, I think it's called, and he plays like little kid number one or something. Then years later, he goes on to play Elvis. So
he just could not escape Elvis.
Yeah.
Could not escape Elvis.
But the AIDS thing. I literally just got done watching it again, and I was listening to the audio commentary with John Carpenter and Kurt Russell, and they pretty much said that was kind of a coincidence. Like they were hearing about the AIDS thing coming out while they were in production, and which is weird because when they first started talking about the virus, they didn't know how you got it. So it was the scary thing that people were getting and dying from and didn't know where it was coming from. So, yeah, that is coincidentally what this movie is basically about. So,
I was going to say, I don't remember anybody having premarital sex in this movie.
And they're all dudes. That's not. Uh-huh. And that's, you don't get that very often at all, you know, especially these days, you know, just, and even they even said there was literally one female crew member. Everybody was a dude on this one.
And that's
interesting only because the dynamic, you know, you don't have any, you know, back then it would have been like, oh, well, the female has to be the love interest, right? And stuff like that. But yeah, I think that's kind of what also makes it interesting. You know, you've got Kurt Russell and he's the reluctant hero, but they're all just a bunch of dudes up in the Arctic. So
just bros hanging out.
Just some dude bros.
Playing solitaire. The only chick is a computer. Cheating bitch.
Bitch.
Like Charlton Heston's Planet of the Apes. Charlton Heston's character is very bigoted and very reluctant about humanity and kind of isolated from it, and yet he asks that question, does brother still make war with himself? And yet he gets that reluctant answer when he goes to that Planet of Apes and realizes that even though he really can't stand all the things that humanity has done, he has to now defend it. And that's sort of nearly the same thing here in the thing. You have MacReady, who's just, you know, a loner pretty much. He doesn't really give a crap. And then when this thing breaks into their cold and slow environment, that's when he realizes, okay, there has to be a line drawn here. One of you guys is not who they say they are. So now it's time to figure out who's who before we get back to our normal life. And that's well reflected at the end, spoiler alert, where they think the creature is defeated, but yet they're not sure. Because they're unsure if either MacReady is the monster or if someone else is the monster. And I think that leaves it on, I don't want to say a bleak note, but more of a question, just how far someone can go just to decipher who is the real monster and who's the real human. And so you find them in the snow kind of pondering this question. It's like, you know, excuse me. It's like that short story, The Lady or the Tiger. It ends on such a cliff note, a cliffhanger, that it's up to you, the audience, to figure out exactly should these characters be given a happy ending or a tragic ending. But the only problem is that no matter which ending you pick, there's going to be a tragic outcome. You could say that MacReady is the creature the entire time, but you could say that Childs, the African-American dude, you could say that, you know, maybe they're not the creature. And it's funny because I read up in an interview, there's a little Easter egg hint that helps you know who is the monster and who isn't. And if I remember correctly, the cinematographer of this film came up, him and John Carpenter came up with a really interesting idea that whoever is human, you can tell they're human in certain scenes because they have this little flicker of light in their eyes, like a little tiny pupil. And you can definitely spot this during the blood scene where they're given all these close-ups and stuff. You can see this little tiny flicker of light that shows that they're human, and those who don't have this little tiny light in the pupil for the eye is pretty much alien. So really look out for that if you're seeing this movie again, or for first comers. Look really close at their eyes, or, like, you know, just frame and zoom in, because if you see that little speck of light in the middle of their eye, that really shows that they're a real human being. If there's nothing but blackness, they're the alien. So for those who want to figure out if MacReady is the monster or not, really do look out for that in the end. Like, really just pause and, you know, zoom if you can, because it's... I figured it out, but you know what? I'm not going to tell you bastards. I'm keeping that for myself. What else to talk about? The practical effects are incredible in this movie. Rob Bottin did a lot of the special effects, and I think when you compare it to today's horror movies, it's not as gory as they make it out to be back then. I saw this for the first time as a television edit, and I remember I didn't really jump onto it. I was like, okay, this is actually kind of interesting. I had a little thing back then where I'd sneak downstairs and see what was on, like, 3 o'clock in the morning or 4 o'clock in the morning. Mostly it was for Freakazoid because it was the only time it came on, or I'd just get up around 2 a.m. just to see Futurama and Family Guy and Adult Swim. These were the high school years. And also at the same time, I started seeing late-night television that way as well.
Early morning Freakazoid.
I just go down, see a movie, sneak back up. The last time I did that was Creepshow. Very sad story. But, well, of course, I got caught that time, so I had to stop that. But the thing was, one of those movies that I saw, and I remember it so well, I didn't really have much... It didn't leave much of an impact. But then later in college, a friend of mine was getting me back into horror movies and stuff. Hell, he even had, like, a little pet rat named Ben. That's how... that's how engrossed he was into the world of horror. He was, like, talking about H.P. Lovecraft and all that sort of stuff. Even had the original published version of The Ratman Diaries, which became Willard. And he lent me a copy of The Thing. And I was just floored by it. I couldn't believe how much I missed. I was like, wow, there's so much greatness in this film.
Still listening.
And I think that was, like, the big stepping stone. Because the biggest fear I have is that movies, horror films, get, like, too gory, too messy, too goopy, too gloppy. And here they do that. But it's not in, like, big doses. They come out at the right spots. They pretty much have these little beats in between to get you out of that horrific moment. The bit with the dog, that's followed up by the mystery of where this creature came from, so you know the information also is touched, and you have the building paranoia. Then you have a scene where one of the characters becomes the first human victim, and that's when you start to realize, okay, this creature can actually become any living human being. And then you have the blood test and so forth and so forth. And as disgusting as these special effects are, Roger Ebert called this a great barf bag movie. There are nasty moments, but I think they're justified by these little story beats to at least give you some time to relax before the next horrific beat happens. Don't get me wrong, it's a very disgusting movie. In fact, I'm actually surprised to see I'm recommending it so highly. But it does seem to linger on a lot in those moments once in a while, but at least Carpenter has the jurisdiction of saying that it's literally complimenting what the first film did, making this very scary, atmospheric kind of movie. You're not immersed in the violence, you're just immersed in, you know, where this creature's going to pop out and scare you, and there are times when that can be effective. It's a different kind of scare. The cold temperatures have this very creepy, eerie kind of feeling. It makes a great Christmas movie, the more you think about it. But no, moving on. What works best is that haunting atmosphere, that cold environment, the fact that they're all trapped in the Antarctic, they don't have any contact outside, with the exception of themselves. So they really have no source of help, and they know that if one of them leaves the building, they could be the creature, and they could spread this thing worldwide. They could be like this weird Cronenberg kind of monster, in a sense. So, with that in mind, it really puts to the fear that we're just one person on this planet, and there's a high probable chance that the next person we meet is going to have an illness, a sickness, or this bizarre creature from another world. And it really emphasizes that fear pretty well, that even if we know this person pretty well, if we know this friend, they could be something entirely different. Anyway, I rambled too much about that theoretical aspect. Back to the special effects. Rob Bottin did them, and he really shows the craft here really well. It's a great testament to special effects. In our world of CGI, I dare ILM and all the others to look back at something like this and say, what made this so effective? You can't imagine all the prosthetics, the puppets they had to go through, everything just to make this creature believable. And this is before computers came in and did things different, so it's such a breath of fresh air to see something in front of you, even if it's gloppy and gooey. And it's probably too late to mention that some of the material they used is the liquids that they used for Twinkie. So when you see that scene where the thing comes out of the chest, remember you're seeing materials from Twinkies being used instead of latex and rubber and animatronics and all that sort of stuff. But the fact that they went all out of their way just to make this monster so different, abstract, and believable, I really appreciate. And here's another thing that makes it all more scarier. You don't see a true form of the monster. You never do. There is a little debate at the end when it pops up and you see like this massive tentacles and stuff where it could be the true form. But even at the same time, you're left to skepticalism because you have no idea what this thing really looks like. Because overall, it's just this massive blob of body parts. And it's such a horrific idea to comprehend that this living thing is just all these different pieces of a person come together to make something so horrific and nightmarish. And I think that really works in the film's favor, because you see so many different variations of this thing. It's like a Salvador Dali or Picasso painting. It's these little different pieces of someone just molded together to make this weird mutant blob. That's what makes it so amazing and unique to watch. Not just for the designs alone, but even for the special effects, it makes it worth watching again and again to just be like, wow, you know, the way in one scene, I think it's the dog kennel scene. If you look really close, there's a bit where it shoots out this little flower, and if you look really close, it's just a massive wad of tongues string together. It's you know, fake looking stuff in terms of, but if you look really close, it's just this massive wad of tongues. It's like this little tiny flower that pops up, and you see like all these tongues and everything just stranded together. It is amazing, and you can tell there's so much detail and effort into this. Now, of course, the thing didn't do well at the box office. Its biggest competitor was another alien movie that Universal released called E.T. the Extraterrestrial, and I think at that point, people wanted more godlike, benevolent aliens that shined lights and stuff. Joe Dante suffered this too with Explorers 3 years later. And it's a shame because the thing was such a very intense thrill ride, and I can see why that could have hampered when E.T. came out, because we needed that breath of fresh air. We needed to be like, okay, aliens are a source of good and stuff. But this movie went back to the traditional roots where it's like, no, they're, you know, evil, mischievous monsters that want to do much harm. And I think that might have hampered the reputation of the box office at the time. But then when home video sales kicked in, it definitely showed a better stride. It later grew on to be more of a thrilling masterpiece from there on in. It's a shame, too, because there's so much effort, so much put into this. John Carpenter at the time even deemed it one of the lesser of his career when the movie bombed. But then over time, they started to respect and appreciate, wait a minute, there's good things about this here, too. There's, like, a lot of great stuff to admire here and there. Shout Factory, subsidiary Scream Factory, did an amazing Blu-ray, which I highly recommend checking out. There, it's jam-packed with many documentaries about the special effects, the editing, directing and such. It even has the TV edit, which is kind of interesting. So you get to see all the little audio changes and stuff, and even some deleted scenes they put in here and there. But I'm going to say, for the foremost, of all the horror movies I've seen, nothing compares to The Thing. Yeah, there's stuff like Day of the Dead and The Shining, which go in psychological and social commentary aspects. But for me, I think one of the perfect examples of well-done horror is this movie, just for its atmosphere, its well-placed scares. You don't see too much of the creature and stuff, and just these really smart characters that know the situation they're in and the risks they have. So I'm going to say, hands down, out of all of John Carpenter's films, it's not Halloween, it's not They Live, it's, you know, Lord forbid, it's not even vampires or ghosts of Mars. Ugh. It's, for me, it's The Thing. It's The Thing. I think it's as perfect of a film as you can get. And I feel bad, because if this did well, maybe there would have been sequels. Maybe there would have been a continuation. Maybe there would have been this whole Halloween franchise in the 80s. Just, you know, different special effects and stuff. But no, I really recommend checking this one out. The only problem is that for first-time watchers, it might seem a little slow, but on repeated viewings, it does get better. So I will address that. It does get better on repeated viewings, but first time around, it might be a little...
For me, it was excellent
sluggish
the first time.
In a sense, but when it gets to those moments, it works. It fully works. And well, yes, I'm aware of the prequel. I don't want to talk about it. God forbid, I don't want to talk about the prequel. It's crap. They tried. They really tried so hard. The characters are not smart. They had an advantage by trying to make... Because, you know, again, without giving too much away, the film... Actually, in the 1982 movie,
election
they referenced that the creature possibly came
bad?
From this Norwegian campsite. And this prequel, which is also called The Thing, by the way. There's no subtitle. It's just called The Thing. Not John Carpenter's The Thing previous or Next Generation. No, it's just The Thing.
The Thang.
They try to make reference
to The Next Generation.
They try to set it all around that Norwegian campsite, which, all right, fine. There would have been some interesting aspects there, like making it the first, you know, Americanized foreign horror movie by having the whole movie, like, putting this Norwegian kind of talk with subtitles and stuff. It could have had a good advantage there, but it doesn't. Half the cast is American, and the other half is Norwegian. They could have made, like, this foreign film over here, because very rarely does that happen. I think Akira Kurosawa's Dreams is the closest to a mainstream, to a foreign film made on mainstream land. This prequel, they try to show the creature for what it is, and it's just this mass of tentacles and beaks, and that's really all I remember, just tentacles and beaks is the big thing.
Funny, I don't remember it at all.
The main character was just not interesting, and when they try to tie it in to the John Carpenter film, it kind of felt a little forced in a sense, because now you know what went on in that site, so there's really no reason to actually go in and revisit the first one all over again. It just ruins a lot of the mystery that Carpenter left in that campsite.
That's why nobody talks about that one anymore.
It ruined a whole lot of the mystery, so I really don't recommend seeing that one at all. It was a huge misfire. And if you're going to have a prequel and call it The Thing, it's clear that you're just banking on name only and not just saying, oh, hey, this is, you know, a new interpretation. No, you made another Thing movie. So it's quite clear that you're going to have attributes and stuff from The Thing. And you know what? The prequel, it feels more like a remake than a prequel. It literally recycles a lot of stuff from the John Carpenter film. And that really bugged the ever-loving hell out of me. Because there's so much material that they bothered. Like, oh, we're going to do a blood test, and they glance it over, and the monster pops out. Just, no. Skip it. See this one. See the 1982 film. It's more awesome. So, yeah, those are my two cents. I just say a lovely, lovely, happy Halloween. And, Matt, wherever you are, a little bit of a quick warning. In about 5 seconds, your pants are going to be set on fire. Take precautions. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Well, glad Matt's not here so we don't have to witness that.
No.
By the way, if you want to know what the true form of the thing is...
It's me!
Yes.
What a twist.
What a twist.
Yes. I had to get dressed for my Target job tonight.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I would say that I know it's probably debatable that you see the thing in its truest form, but even on the commentary, they said, like, even the tentacles, even whatever you see, it's been to countless different planets, probably, and, you know, you're not seeing any true form of it, likely. You're just seeing whatever. It's just like a parasite, and that's what's so scary about it.
It's like the body snatchers. Do they have a true form?
Yep, exactly. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Halloween 3 is basically like a body snatchers type movie, too.
You know.
So, yeah. Yeah, the thing, the Halloween might be my favorite John Carpenter movie, but The Thing, I would admit, is a better made film because it's so, man. The ambitiousness of it, they filmed a lot of it on studio sets, but it does have that more confined, like, it feels like one of those movies that they talk about that was like, oh, this was hell to film and all that kind of stuff. It just seems like more dangerous, and all the fire and everything, it just, yeah, it's nuts. Oh, yeah. And the effects.
Yeah, I remember watching the spaceship shot and mm-hmm. the different cycles that they had to go through. It's like all matted in together. I'm just thinking, that's all practical, and nowadays you would do it all digital.
It looks so good still.
It's aged beautifully. If you remade this movie now the way that it is, it would still be effective.
Mm-hmm. It's like how a lot of those original Star Wars models still look. There's a different look to them than, like, the computer stuff.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Indeed. We've had this discussion before on CR, so
mm-hmm.
plenty of times, but it keeps coming back.
Yep.
Yeah, if you love movies, it'll keep coming back.
It does. It keeps coming back.
Those effects, I'll tell you. And the tragic part about that remake prequel thingy, whatever shouldn't have been, is that they filmed most of that movie with practical stuff, and then the studio told them to scrap it all for CG effects because video games are so popular. That's what I've heard. Like, that was the reason for that, was that they wanted it to look, the studio wanted it to look like computer effects, even though the filmmakers went in promising the fans that it was going to be a practical movie like John Carpenter's was. That is the tragic part. They have a ton of photographs of all the scrapped practical effects that they made and filmed.
No, even if you're playing video games, you know for a fact that what you're looking at it is
fake. Yeah, I know. That's a studio executive for you. I mean, what kind of goofy thinking is that?
If you're amazed by the graphics, you can be amazed by the graphics all you want, but you know it's not real.
Yeah. They're not trying
they
to
get as close it. To that as possible. No.
Yeah.
Stupid. Yeah, I remember being stupid.
I remember being confused too by that prequel because it was before I was like, oh, it's the Norwegian camp. I thought Joel Edgerton was being cast to like play a younger Kurt Russell almost. He kind of looked like him a little bit without the really big beard.
But
but anyway, we don't have to talk about that one.
I gotta get things moving here so we get I'd suggest we wrap this up.
Yes, we're gonna wrap this up. John Carpenter has been known for many things, and these films provide that as proof. So what is your favorite John Carpenter film? Please leave a comment below, and I'll check them out if you do that. Otherwise, thanks for watching this episode of Cinema Royale. Thanks to David Rose for coming on this special episode.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Mm-hmm. Otherwise, have a nice day. Thanks for watching, and good night.
Happy Halloween.
Ciao for now,
suckers.